On September 28, 1903, an unusual if not unprecedented execution occurred when three brothers died one after the other in the Sing Sing electric chair. Willis, Frederick, and Burton Van Wormer, of vintage Dutch family, were doomed for the Christmas Eve, 1901 murder of their uncle. The family trees branching over generations had put family enmities between relatives. In this case, working stiff John Van Wormer's home, in Columbia County, New York, was mortgaged to his brother-in-law, and the eventual murder victim, Peter Hollenbeck. After John passed away, Peter lowered the boom and foreclosed on the widow, booting John's sons out of the house. The boys got even, with an unsubtle gangland masked home raid, riddling their Uncle Scrooge with bullets. Signs of the times, the murder happened mere weeks after William McKinley's assassination, and testimony had one of the boys bragging with reference to the fatal gunshot wound inflicted on the late president. "I made a chogosh shot. I shot him in the stomach." Though these three attracted national public sympathy, someone even telegrammed a bogus reprieve signed, "The President of the United States," in a vain stab at delay. Their case was pretty open and shut. A solemn hush hung over Clinton Prison that morning, and the bright skies, bad given way to dull, leaden clouds which threatened rain at any moment. Within their narrow cells in the death house, Willis, Burton and Frederick Van Wormer were making final preparations to meet their maker. They spent practically a sleepless night, and it was not until about 3 o'clock that morning that they said goodnight to each other and dropped off into a sound slumber. When their supper was taken in last sight, shortly before 10 o'clock, Burton, who occupies a cell across from Willis and Frederick, remarked that he was not afraid to die and would meet death bravely. "I have no more fear of going to that chair," he said to Keeper Nash, "than I have of eating my supper. I can stand it to see the other boys go and be last to meet my fate." The boys looked forward eagerly to the visit in the morning of Father Bellanger and his assistant, Father Charbonneau. The priests watered the prison, once to the death's chamber to administer the first and last communion. State electrician Davis was at the prison at 7 o'clock to see that final preparations were complete. He examined the clothing, to see that the legs of the trousers were properly slit to the line, to allow the easy application of the electrode. The prison barber visited the Van Wormer brothers in their cell and shaved a portion of the hair from their heads, to allow the adjustment of the helmet prison routine unchanged. "There will be no change in the prison routine on account of the executions, and the men will march in at the usual time. Although, as is always the case, efforts have been made to keep the affair from becoming known among the convicts, yet because of the unaccountable way in which news travels about the prison, there are few among the 1,000 prisoners who do not know that three young lives are to be blotted. The boys will be the 13th, 14th and 15th victims to meet death in Clinton's execution chamber. Seven were executed in the original chair, the last being the famous Bat-Shay. A new and stronger chair was then built at the prison, and it is in this the boys will sit. While some of the witnesses arrived a day before, the majority arrived on the morning train. When William T. Murphy, the death watch, left the death house at 8 o'clock that morning, the boys all shook hands with him and bade him goodbye, thanking him for the kindness he had shown them. Home, friends and their fate of the chair were freely discussed by the boys before they retired on their last night. By tomorrow night at this time, I suppose we will all be back in Kinderhook, remarked one of them. I wish there were three chairs, so we could all go together, said Fred. Willis was first to announce his intention of retiring. It was 2:10 in the early morning hours when he bid the others good night and went to his cot. Half an hour later, Fred and Burton said good night, after requesting that they be called at 7 o'clock. All three went to sleep almost immediately and slept soundly until 7:16, when they were awakened by Mr. Murphy. They greeted him and asked of each other how they felt. Each said he felt equal to the order he was about to face. They decided that Willis should be permitted to go first, because of his health and consequent weakness. Willis, throughout his long confinement, has been afflicted with lung trouble. Up to the very hour, even that morning, Willis has taken a spoonful of cod liver oil after each meal. It was this condition of his health that determined the others as to his right to first consideration in the death march to the chair. The boys spent the greater part of their last night in reading their Bible. It was passed repeatedly from one cell to another, each marking passages which seemed to particularly interest them and to which they desired to direct the special attention of the others. A tearful parting. Although the boys retained their nerve, they did display some weakness on the final parting with the death watch, who had been their most intimate associate during their long confinement. When it came to the final parting, Fred, the youngest, broke down completely and wept piteously. His distress was clearly in the parting rather than in the thought of his impending death. Warden Dale, that morning, announced, "The list of witnesses, the witnesses have started for the death's chamber." 11:32, after the usual test of the chair with a bank of incandescent lamps, the first man, Willis Van Wormer, oldest of the brothers, has been summoned. 11:34, Willis Van Wormer has entered the death's chamber. 11:36, current turned into his body. 11:37, Willis Van Wormer declared dead. 11:41, Frederick has entered death's chamber. 11:42, current turned on Frederick. 11:43, Frederick declared dead. 11:47, Burton enters death's chamber. 11:48, current turned on Burton. 11:48, Burton declared dead. The triple execution had been completed within just 15 minutes. Since they were doing death as a brother act, it was only fair that they sort out precedence within the family. The condemned themselves decided the order of their execution, with Willis first, Frederick second, and Burton third. But leave it to the youngest child to stick out from the crowd. Frederick, the baby of the family, actually managed to survive the electric chair, sort of. Not walk clean away from it like Willie Francis would do, but impolitely revive when he was supposed to be laid out dead like folk used to do back in the bad old hanging days. The executions went off without a hitch and the brothers were pronounced dead. Later, after they had been laid out in the autopsy room, a guard saw one of them out in the autopsy room, Frederick Van Wormer, move a hand. Then an eye flickered. The prison doctor was immediately summoned. Putting a stethoscope to the dead man's heart, he discovered it was still beating. Frederick's heart was bigger than that of anyone executed up to that date, so two charges of full current had failed to kill him. The convict was carried back to the chair and kept in it until, He was dead beyond the shadow of a doubt. He died without actually being re-executed. In part because of accidents like these, during the early decades of the electric chair, numbers of people weren't convinced it was as deadly as it was supposed to be. A fellow by the name of Edward Anthony Spitzka autopsied the Van Wormers, directing his attention especially to the brains. The opportunity afforded by this triple execution was certainly most rare, and a similar case will not soon occur again, and found Frederick with a robust 1.6 kilograms brain, compared to less than 1.4 kilograms for his siblings. The rare fact that three brothers from the same parents were executed on the same day, the medical examiner left no stone unturned. During their autopsy, he did a comparison of their organs and their brains. Willis was 26 years, Frederick was 20, and Burton Van Wormer was 24 years at the time of their executions. Thank you for watching Death Row.